has come. Jesus saves. Mercy triumphs at the cross. Love has come to rescue us. Jesus saves. Hope is here. What a joyful noise we'll make as we join with heaven's song.
On lonely hills. ahead and stand as we get started today.
How great you are, your greatness I can fathom, upholding God by your mighty word. The universe fulfills your every purpose, and all you make will bring you praise of God. You are glorious, glorious, and we will lift our voices to worship you. You are
everybody. All right. Hey, welcome today. And it is such a good day to be here. I'm glad to see you. And if you are one of our guests this morning, maybe it's your first time with us, we just want to say we're glad that you're here. Hope you feel welcomed and encouraged this morning. And again, if you have any questions at all about our church, and this applies for anyone and everyone who's here, I encourage you to check out our welcome desk on your way out today. Information that you would like to learn about our church or questions or clarifications, that's a great resource for you. We also have a gift for you back there as well, especially if you're one of our first-time guests and we just want to connect more with you. So with that in mind, again, just we're glad that you're here. If you're joining us online this morning, also just want to say welcome. We're sad we can't be with you in person, but glad that we can connect remotely in that way. And again, God has been faithful to us. Couple things just want to remind us of, and always want to refer you back to bulletins. We have those available on that back table in there. But as far as giving, just encourage you to kind of keep on track where we're at with our giving up to date, and we have a report on that in our bulletin each week. But for giving, we have our offering box against the back wall. You can give online through our website, or if you go to the App Store, you can download the Faith Life app. You can also go to our touch screen in the back, and there's a tab for giving, and you can put your phone right up to it, and it'll take you right to the page for doing that as well. So those are some different ways that you can do that. Talking about our touch screen, just want to remind you of some things that we have as a resource back there. We're trying to update, and I'm going to coordinate with Pastor Dave a little bit more on this as well, but for women's Bible study in particular, every week we have a reminder what chapter is going to be going over that upcoming week for Bible study. We have some resources for how to go deeper within that study for women's ministry, so some different video links or podcasts that you could listen to that would just kind of enrich what the study is going over, and we'll try to implement some of those things for Ironman as well. But if you have any just questions, just need that reminder, what are we going over this week? What are some significant things happening in that? Encourage you on Sundays, check out our touch screen and find out some more information about that. Another great place to go to for information, though, with our touch screen has to do with our missionaries. So we have 9 different missionaries that we are supporting or partnering with, and we update all of our newsletters with them. We try to keep current on pictures and just what is going on in their lives, what prayer requests they have. And so if you don't know who our missionaries are, or if you would just like to connect more with them, I encourage you to go back into the touchscreen, click on the missions part. You can see their different pictures. You can click on them, and there's a lot of great information just as a way that we can connect more as a global family, so to speak, in trying to partner and sharing the gospel. So I would encourage you to do just that. As far as an encouragement I want to give, one of the roles that I have here at Christ Fellowship is really that membership and kind of assimilation process. And I want to just give this invitation and this encouragement. If you are currently not a member here and you've thought about that, maybe you've prayed about that, maybe you've been toying with that in the back of your mind, and there could be a whole number of reasons why you have not taken that step, I want to encourage you to consider doing that. And so I want to kind of frame that real brief with some of the reasons why we do membership. And one of the first arguments, I mean that in a positive way, that we would make for why we do membership here is when we think about Scripture, and we think about in Scripture we are called to hold one another accountable. From a church leadership standpoint, we're called to hold one another accountable. We also see in Scripture the different offices of elder and deacon, and we also see over and over in Scripture all of the descriptions of spiritual gifts and different ministry skill sets. And when we think about accountability and church offices and spiritual gifts, really something that I think is inferred by that is all of those make most sense in a local church context. Okay? You can't have church offices that are just general across the whole board. We are elders and deacons of who or of whom, so to speak. And that also applies with spiritual gifts and their applications and so on and so forth. And so I think there is a really solid argument you can make based off Scripture for the need to have local church bodies. And if there's a need to have local church bodies, there's also a need to be committed to local church bodies. And that's where membership comes in. It's not something where we're trying to be legalistic about it, but rather we think that it's so important that we can commit to one another, that we're going to link arms, we're going to extend grace, we're going to extend trust, we're going to extend accountability, so that collectively we can be about the mission of making disciples. And that's what church membership is, and that's why we want to be about that. So I want to encourage you, if you've considered that, if you've been kind of maybe on the fence about that, I would absolutely love to talk to you. If there's questions you might have, I'd love to attempt to answer those questions. And based off of kind of need, we will either do an official class and kind of work. That was unexpected. Work through the specific, content for that. I can also be very flexible in that. Would love to just grab coffee. I can meet up with you individually or family-wise. And, would love to talk with you more about that. But, again, encourage you to prayfully consider that. Our passage this morning, and I would invite you to stand with me as we get to read this today, is from Matthew chapter 16, and we're going to look at verses 13 through 16. You could argue this is one of the most critical passages and one of the most critical questions that every single one of us needs to answer in life. And so I hope you have an answer to this question, and if you don't, I would plead with you today, do not leave here without having a solid answer to this question. Here's what the Word of God says. Matthew 16, verse 13. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter replied, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's exactly who Jesus is. Would you pray with me? God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for our time together. Thank you for what your word says. And Jesus, we do believe that you are the Son of the living God. You are our Savior. You are our Redeemer. You're the one who forgives us of all of our sin. And today we just want to thank you for that. Would you bless our time? Would you prepare us as we worship, as we hear from your word? And thank you for being faithful to us. In your name, amen.
Who shall we say you are? You're the living God. Who shall we say you are? You're the great I am, the highest name of all. You're all you say you are. What heart could hold the weight of your love?
Father, we thank you so much that while we were yet sinners, you sent Jesus Christ to come and save us, born of a virgin, led a sinless life, died on the cross in our place, to where he took our sins upon himself, and he rose again on the third day. And Father, we thank you that because of these things, our sins are forgiven. We have been set free from sin. We have been given a right standing with you. And we are so thankful this morning for the gospel. We are so thankful for your love for us. We are so thankful to be your children. We thank you for everything that you have done for us, and it's only because of Jesus Christ. And so we pray all of this in his name this morning. Amen.
I want to begin by thanking Pastor Marcus for preaching last week. That gave me the opportunity to take a week and go down to Ecola Bible College with my wife and teach for 5 days. We had the chance to minister to a class that focused on the Protestant Reformation and the theology of the Protestant Reformation, the five solas of the Reformation. It was a wonderful week together. And I should tell you that there was a bit of a black cloud that was hanging over the campus because several students that week were ill and some were unable to come to class. And so those that were sick would watch the class through live video feed and then they would come later as they were more fully recovered. So thank you for your prayers for us as we were gone. We look forward to going back down again in April, where I will teach one of my all-time favorite classes on the Pilgrim's Progress. This is an exposition of John Bunyan's work, The Pilgrim's Progress, so we're looking forward to that. I want to invite you to open your Bibles today and turn with me to Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. And as you make your way to Romans 10, would you stand together as we read these verses from verses 5 to 10. Romans 10. Verses 5 to 10. This is the written word of God. For Moses writes about the righteousness that is based on the law, that the person who does the commandments shall live by them. But the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is, to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, what is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Let's pray together. Lord, as always, it is a high honor to open your word, to read it, to meditate upon it, to study it, to proclaim it, to hear it, to obey it. Thank you for this passage of Scripture that will remind us of some important realities. May we ponder these things in our hearts and may we be changed for the better. I pray for those who are not yet Christians today, that today would be the day of salvation, that there would be a day of reckoning, there would be a day of forgiveness, there would be a day where someone new enters the kingdom of God. So we look forward to all that you'll do in our midst. May we be completely surrendered to the truth of your word, all for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, the title of the message today is Salvation, Coming to Terms with Eternity. And I want to begin by making the statement that concerns the devil. Yes, the devil. One of the devil's favorite tricks is to mock the notion of salvation. You might be wondering what in the world I'm talking about. Well, you will hear this mocking of salvation from unbelieving people when they either poke fun at or ridicule the notion of being saved. In fact, I've even discovered over the years that from time to time, you will hear professing Christians undermining salvation in the church when they speak in sarcastic tones or in jest about being saved. Why does the devil have this need to mock the need for salvation? I think there are several reasons he does it. The main reason he mocks salvation is because he hates the living God. He hates the Word of God. And of course, the devil hates the commandments of God. See, the devil knows that when the sinner is saved, that instantly he or she is transferred from the domain of darkness to the domain of light. That's exactly what Paul says in Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 and 14. That God has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. Think about that for a moment. If you are a professing follower of Jesus Christ, you are no longer a resident of the kingdom of the darkness. You are a resident of the kingdom of light. You have been redeemed. All your sins are forgiven. Everything in the past. You say everything? Everything. Even the really dark, dirty stuff. Everything in the past is forgiven. Everything today and every sin that you will commit in the future is covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen? You see, God invites sinners to be saved. This is this divine invitation from a gracious God. But he not only invites sinners to be saved, he demands that sinners be saved. One verse in the book of Acts that will quickly come onto your lips, and you may have learned it as a child, is in Acts 16:31, that says, "Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved." That verb, believe, is an imperative verb. In other words, God is not only inviting you to become a Christian, he is demanding that you become a Christian. In addition, God warns about the consequences of refusing to be saved. John chapter 3, verse 36. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. And so the devil mocks salvation because he hates God, he hates the Word of God, he hates the commandments of God. But we also see that the devil understands that when the sinner is saved, the penalty of sin is broken forever. Third, the devil understands that when the sinner is saved, the power of sin is broken. Not only the penalty of sin, but the power of sin is broken. If you are a Christian today, you have the ability, you have the inclination, you have the divine desire to say no to sin. You have the ability to walk in purity. You have the ability to live a holy life. You couldn't have said that 1 second prior to becoming a Christian. And then finally, the devil understands that when the sinner is saved, his work is thwarted. His work is finished. 1 John chapter 3, verse 8, the reason the Son of God, the reason he appeared was to destroy the works of the devil. I love the Heidelberg Confession. And there's a line in day number one, Lord's Day number one, that says this, that Jesus has fully paid for my sins with his precious blood, and he has set me free from the tyranny of the devil. I took the liberty to look the word tyranny up, and here is what I discovered. Some synonyms: absolute power, autocracy, dictatorship, totalitarianism, fascism, oppression, suppression, repression, enslavement, authoritarianism, high-handedness, bullying, harshness, cruelty, brutality, ruthlessness. Here's my favorite one: reign of terror. Reign of terror. The Heidelberg Catechism tells us that Jesus has set me free from Satan's reign of terror. If you are an unbeliever today, if you are not yet a Christian, you need to understand who your commanding officer is. If you are not yet a follower of Jesus Christ, your boss, your CEO, your the most important person is in your life right now is the devil. Jesus said it like this: you are of your father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. And so if you're not yet a Christian, your boss is the devil. Secondly, if you're not yet a Christian, you need to understand that you're living under the direct control of Satan. And yes, there is a being that has existed that God created originally as a holy angel, but he rebelled, and his name is the devil. Jesus answered and said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, anyone who practices sin is a slave to sin." That's true of every unbelieving person. And then I want you to know that if you're not a Christian yet this morning, that the devil will literally do anything to prevent you from being saved. Let me try to get into the psychological profile of the devil. If I were the devil, just for 30 seconds, if I were the devil and you're not a Christian, here is the strategy I would use with you. You tend to think that the devil would show up as this monstrous creature and try to scare the willies out of you. No, he's far too smart for that. If I were the devil, I would want you to think for the next 30 minutes what you're having for lunch today. I would want you, if you're in charge of preparing the lunch, I would want you to be thinking about what temperature you set the smoker at and whether or not your house is going to still be there when you get home. That you set the oven to the correct temperature, that it's preheated to the right temperature, or if you put a roast in, that you didn't put it in too soon. If I were the devil, I would want you to think about all those culinary delights that preoccupy your attention so you're no longer concerned with the Word of God. Now, because the devil is a sports fan, if I were the devil, I would want you to be thinking about the Kansas City Chiefs for the next 30 minutes. Because there's a big game today. If I were the devil, I would want you thinking about the Los Angeles Rams. Because that's another big game that'll occur today. If I were the devil, I would do anything in my power to distract your attention from the Word of God. That means that the Bible would be closed. That means that your ears would be closed to what I'm going to share for the next several minutes. Why would I do that? Because I would do anything if I were the devil to prevent you from being saved. If you're a Christian, and many of you are, be careful not to take a casual approach to the text before us and the matters before us today. Why? You will come face to face with a passage that you have probably heard hundreds of times, especially verses 9 and 10. And the vulnerability for professing followers of Christ is to pass this text off to your unbelieving neighbor. But the passage before us, as we'll soon discover, is just as important for you as it is for your unbelieving friend. And so if you're a Christian today, your challenge, let me give this challenge to you, is to be reminded and to be refreshed about the joy of your salvation. I read years and years ago, one of my favorite authors, John Piper, talked about the fight for joy. And I remember when I first discovered John Piper's emphasis on the fight for joy, it didn't take long to convince me that indeed the Christian race is a fight for joy. Let me prove it. Raise your hand if you're here and you can honestly say that every day you wake up joyful and you stay joyful all through the afternoon, all through the evening, until the time you put your head back on the pillow, that joy is what marks your life. It's no big deal, Pastor. I see no hands. I see. You see, John Piper's right. Is we are in this massive struggle, and a large part of the battle is just this. It's the fight for joy. And so may I remind you to take part in that fight, to be refreshed and to delight in the joy of your salvation. I want you to see that the matter of salvation is the most consequential issue that anyone could ever face. When you seriously think about eternity, you quickly begin to realize that literally everything is on the line. Everything is on the line. Heaven, hell, judgments, rewards. I'll put it this way. Eternity is for keeps. How long is eternity? I can just imagine a four-year-old answer. Pastor, that's a long time. Just keep saying long, because eternity lasts forever. Even, curiously enough, even the secular world sees the value of thinking long-term. There is an author who I became fascinated with in the late 80s and the early 90s. He has since died. He was in a tragic bicycle accident, not a professing follower of Christ, but he's a man who wrote in the field of business and personal productivity. And here's what he said. He said, it is important, it is absolutely crucial that we begin with the end in mind. That sounds Christian to me, that we begin with the end in mind. What he's really thinking here is that we need to have an eternal perspective. He says, quote, to begin with the end in mind means to start with a clear understanding of your destination. It means to know where you're going so that you better understand where you are now and so that the steps you take are always in the right direction. He continues, how different our lives are when we really know what is deeply important to us, and keeping that picture in mind, we manage ourselves each day to be and to do what really matters most, close quote. Those are from the lips of an unbelieving person. He gets it, even as a non-Christian. Now, if a secular book on personal productivity encourages you and I to think long-term, how much more should Christians think eternally? And so I would summarize it like this. Eternity is no laughing matter. This topic has massive implications that will affect you forever and ever and ever. Before we jump to the text and look at it in greater detail, come with me and notice the subject of salvation and how it is literally sprinkled all throughout the pages of Scripture. Now, in your notes, you'll see several passages, and you don't need to turn there for our purposes for the next few minutes. I just want you to see the biblical evidence for salvation, the salvation that Satan seeks to mock, the salvation that Satan makes light of, and the salvation that I hear some Christians even make light of. We begin in Romans 10:9 that we'll explore in greater detail in a moment. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be what? You'll be saved. In Matthew chapter 19, verses 23 to 25, we hear this language, who then can be saved? Acts 2:21, and it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, this is a phrase that we will look at next week, that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. In fact, just for a moment, look with me at Romans 10:14, and this is where we're going to go next week. Paul says, how then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? Back to Acts 2:21, that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Acts 4:12, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. That verse is very controversial in our world today, because we have world religions, competing world religions that say there are different ways to God. We have talk show hosts. We have multimillionaires who are standing before the television camera saying that there are many roads to God, there are many pathways to God, and the Word of God tells us in no uncertain terms that there is only one way we can be saved. It's through the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Acts chapter 11, verses 13 and 14. We read, he will declare to you a message by which you will be saved, you and your household. Acts 15:11, but we believe that we'll be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. Luke 19:10, the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Paul says in 1 Timothy 1:15, this is a saying that is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came to the world to save sinners. 2 Timothy 1:9, Paul refers to God who saved us and called us to a holy life. James 1:21, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your souls. 1 Corinthians 1:18, Paul says the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. 1 Corinthians 1:21, he says, for since on the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, it pleased God through the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. And of course, we all know Ephesians 2:8. Scripture says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is a gift of God. And then Romans 10:13, we will look at this next week. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is just a sampling of the text in the New Testament that point to our need for salvation. Every boy and every girl needs to be saved. Every teenager needs to be saved. Every man, every woman, it doesn't matter what your age, it doesn't matter what your gender, it doesn't matter what your background is, it doesn't matter what your skin color is, it doesn't matter who your favorite football team is, you must be saved. You must be saved. And so our approach this morning is to answer three very basic questions. I'll give these to you in advance. Number one, why do we need to be saved? Number two, what do we need to be saved from? And then finally, how shall we be saved? Here's the first question. Why do we need to be saved? Well, tragically, when we look at Romans 10, the question of salvation for the Jews, because you'll recall that Paul has his sights focused in intensely in Romans 9, 10, and 11 on Israel. And we see in Romans 10, as we have in Romans 9, that for the Jews, salvation wasn't a big deal for them. Why? They thought that since Abraham was their daddy, that eternity, it was done, it was settled, it was not a big deal for them, and nothing could be further from the truth. Look at Romans chapter 10, verses 5 to 8 again. For Moses writes about the righteousness that is based on the law, that the person who does the commandments shall live by them. But the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the abyss, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth and on your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. I want you to see three lessons before we dig deeper into this section of Scripture. Number one, if you live by the law, and that's quite a statement, if you live by the law, if you're a rule keeper, if you live by the law, you will die by the law. James chapter 2, verse 10 says, whoever keeps the whole law but fails at one point becomes guilty of all of it. One of my favorite talks I gave when I was a youth pastor that I've probably shared other times in other venues is when I tried to make this point. And I would try to get the students to understand that they were all lawbreakers. And I would pose the question, how many of you have come to the place where there's a couple of the commandments, or even one commandment that you haven't broken? And there was always someone in the group who would raise their hand. Yeah, there's one that I haven't broken. Some of the more bold students would say, yeah, there are two or three that I haven't broken. And so I would come prepared with this Miracle Whip jar, and I would take my Sharpie, and I'd draw a pie on it with 10 pieces of pie representing the 10 commandments. And then I'd label 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I'd look over, and I'd say to Susie, have you kept all the commandments? And she would say, no, I haven't. I said, are there any that you haven't yet violated? Yeah, I haven't committed adultery. I'm not even married. And so I would find that commandment in the Ten Commandments, and I would take my hammer with my protective eyeglasses on, and I would hit the commandment that she hadn't broken, or that she had broken yet, right? And what would happen? The Miracle Whip jar is shattered. That's the lesson of James 2. You break one, someone help me. You break them all. You break one, you break them all. And so what Paul is trying to point out in verses 6 and 7 that is that living the Christian life doesn't involve some higher level experience. No, that's not it at all. He says this, you will never be able to keep the law. You'll never be able to keep the law. Works-based righteousness will fail every time and lead the well-meaning person to eternal judgment. I want you to see as we take a deeper dive into these verses, four reasons that we need to be saved. And these are very simple reasons, but also very profound. Number one, we need to be saved because we are under a curse. I find it interesting that a lot of Disney movies that I watch, a lot of fiction that becomes popular, there's always this notion of a curse. Have you figured that out? It's fascinating. We live under a curse. Genesis 2:15-17 says, the Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day you eat of it, you shall surely die. What did the man and woman do? They violated the law of God. They violated his commands. We're under a curse. Galatians 3:10 says, all who rely on works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed be everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law and do them. We are not only under a curse, we are sinners by nature and choice. We are sinners by nature and choice. Paul says in Romans 5, just as sin came into the world through one man, that is Adam, and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. Question number 8, or Lord's Day 8 in the Heidelberg Catechism says this. Question, but are we so corrupt that we are totally unable to do any good and prone toward all evil? Answer, yes, unless we are born again by the Spirit of God. In other words, we need to be saved. We're under a curse. We're sinners by nature and choice. Number 3, we need to be saved because we have violated God's holy law. That much we have already seen. Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. Isaiah 53, verse 6, picks up on this theme that says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Finally, we need to be saved because we have failed to glorify God. I have often thought about the verse that I memorized as a child in Romans, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Can I have my candy bar now? You remember those days? Do I get a prize now? I said the Awana verse. For all have sinned, but fall short of the glory of God. And it wasn't until I was older that I realized the gravity of that sin. I knew as a boy that I was a sinner, but I failed to understand until later in my Christian life that I have fallen short of the glory of God. And everyone who falls short of the glory of God, which, by the way, is the reason he created us. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 7, that says that he creates all people for this purpose, to glorify the living God. We who are sinners by nature and choice have failed to glorify that God. That is to say, we heap a great insult on the great worthiness of his name, his plans, and his purposes, which is to say this, we all deserve to perish in our sins. Let me say it more explicitly, we all deserve to go to hell. Why? We have failed to glorify God. And so the greatest need of every person is to be saved. And so with that in mind, we don't mock the language of salvation. We don't marginalize the message of salvation. What do? We simply receive it. We embrace it. But we need to move to our second question, namely, what do we need to be saved from? What do we need to be saved from? And I'm convinced if we receive a solid answer to this question, we will never again mock the language of salvation. And when we hear our unbelieving friends mock the language of salvation, those Christians, they're just trying to save people. We will be able to interact with our unbelieving friends at a deeper level and to show them, do you have any idea what you're saying when you mock the notion of salvation? What do we need to be saved from? Well, four things, believe it or not. Number one, we need to be saved from the penalty of sin. One day, each of us in this room will stand before a holy God and we will give an account of our lives. And we will give an accounting of literally everything that we have said, everything that we have done, everything that we have thought, every false motive, every good deed, every bad deed. And our so-called attempts at achieving righteousness on our own strength will be met with stern judgment. Isaiah chapter 64, verse 6 says, "We have all become like those who are unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away." Most of the men here probably have the rag. How many of you guys know what the rag is? It's that rag that has got dirt on it and dust on it and grease on it. It's been under the hood of your car. It's been around the lawnmower. It's on your bike chain. It's everything. It's the rag. And like, don't touch the rag, right? That's my special cleaning rag, right? If you have a rag like I do, it's a mess. It's filled with grease and grime. And that's exactly what Isaiah chapter 64 says about us, even in our so-called righteousness. We need to be saved from the penalty of sin. Secondly, we need to be saved from the power of sin. Psychologists tell us that the biggest problem among people in our time is unresolved guilt. Unresolved guilt. But what they fail to tell us is that this unresolved guilt is a direct result of our rebellion against a holy God. What do psychologists do? They're on the right track when they talk about unresolved guilt, but they don't go far enough. What do? They say you're guilty because of something that happened in your childhood, hearkening back to Sigmund Freud. Well, Freud had it wrong. Carl Jung had it wrong. Rogers had it wrong. They failed to tell us that this guilt is only the direct result of rebelling against God, who is altogether holy. It's a result of our sin. Therefore, you and I need to be saved and delivered from the power of sin. Number three, this is something that I have learned that people in the church don't even like to confess or to admit, and I think it's a tragedy. I have had pastors tell me, stop emphasizing this. I kid you not, and that is this, that we need to be saved from the wrath of God. Can you imagine a pastor who would say to any other pastor, stop telling people they need to escape or be saved from the wrath of God? You know my response to that pastor? God help us. Because I know the people that I love in this congregation, the people that I love in this community, the people that I love in my family, we all need to be delivered from the wrath of God. I want to show you the warning from Jonathan Edwards. You need to understand that Jonathan Edwards was a prolific writer. He literally preached hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of sermons. He was an amazing man of God, and he wrote this sermon, and he preached it at least twice that I know of, called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And he said the following, "There are black clouds of God's wrath now hanging directly over your heads, full of the dreadful storm and big with thunder, and were it not for the restraining hand of God, it would immediately burst forth upon you. He said, the bow of God's wrath is bent, and the arrows made ready on the string, and justice bends at the arrow of your heart and strains at the bow, and it is nothing but the mere pleasure of God, and that of an angry God, without any promise or obligation at all, that keeps the arrow one moment from being made to be drunk with your blood. You say, wow. Wow. I'll never forget the small group I was in. I was not the leader of the group. My friend Don was the leader of the group, and my wife and I went with our children along with probably six or seven other couples who also brought their children. We're talking little kids. And we came one night and Don said, folks, I've decided that we're going to read The Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God by Jonathan Edwards, the whole thing, on our knees. And we all got on our knees, including the children, and read statements like this. And I will tell you, I will never forget it. I will never forget it. You say, Pastor, I don't want my children to be afraid of hell. I want mine to be afraid of hell. Pastor, I don't want my children to be afraid of the wrath of God. I want my children to be afraid of the wrath of God. Because I don't ever want to endure the wrath of God, and I don't want you to endure it either. Well, that's a warning from Edwards. You say, what about the Bible? Well, notice the warning from the Apostle Paul. And we looked at this verse many, many months ago, maybe years ago. Romans chapter 2, verses 6 to 8. He says, he will render to each one, that is, God will render to each one according to his works, to those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking, who do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. And so you see, it's not only the language of Puritans like Jonathan Edwards, it's the language of inspired writers like Paul the Apostle. How about the Apostle John, who was more mild-mannered, more gentle than the Apostle Paul? We read this earlier in John 3:36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Finally, look at the warning from the lips of Jesus. Jesus, we read in Matthew 13, says, we learn about this, the Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out his kingdom, all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. The simple reality is that we need to be saved from the penalty of sin, the power of sin, the wrath of God, and here is the finale. We need to be saved from God. We need to be saved from God. John chapter 8, verse 24, Jesus says, I told you that you would die in your sins, for unless you believe that I am, he will die in your sins. And then Paul tells us in Romans 5, 9, since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God? We need to be saved from God's wrath. We need to be saved from God. Finally, number three, and we'll close. How can we be saved? How can we be saved? And the answer to this question has been answered by various philosophies and various religions throughout the ages. You name the religious tradition. Today in Veritas, we talked about the Church of Jesus Christ Latter-day Saints, the Mormon Church. You think about Buddhism. You think about Hinduism, a vast range of religious movements. Each of these involves man climbing the ladder to achieve his salvation, his exaltation, his nirvana, whatever the religious tradition. The Bible offers a completely different path, and it is the only path, and it is an exclusive path. And we heard it earlier in Acts chapter 4. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. That is the answer How can we be saved? Only one way. Notice verses 9 and 10. Paul says, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. What's the only way to be saved? Number one, verse 9, confession. Confession. The Greek word is homologeo. It means to make an open and free declaration of something. And that something in this context is that Jesus is Lord. Are you willing to confess that Jesus is Lord? Is that your confession? Now, an authentic confession, according to Paul the Apostle, involves making an open declaration. That is a public declaration that Jesus is Lord. That is exactly what happens in the waters of baptism. When Reese came and was baptized, he publicly proclaimed, he publicly confessed that a while back in my journey, a while back in my pilgrimage, I confessed that Jesus is Lord. And today, I stand before my church family and I confess that Jesus is Lord. There's only one way to be saved. We confess with our mouth, and then Paul says we believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. And I want to focus here on that verb to believe. The Greek word is pistuo or pistis, and it simply means this, to accept as true. This is the Greek word for faith. So belief equals faith. Faith equals belief. Next week we'll see it also means to call upon the name of the Lord. Call on the Lord, believe, demonstrate faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so genuine faith requires believing in our hearts that God raised Jesus from the dead. So if you're here and you say, I just can't believe in a person who was crucified, who was placed in a tomb, and 3 days later, raised from the dead. If you're here and you say that, you will not be saved. You see, we must confess in our hearts and believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is who he said he is and did what he did, namely raise from the grave. As we close, I want to walk you through something that will be brand new for some of you, and for others of you, you've heard this before, but I have found that it always bears repeating. Because we are in a time, a unique time in 2022, where preachers who call people to believe, who call people to have faith in Jesus, doesn't mean now what it meant 300 years ago. Do you know when Jonathan Edwards stood before his congregation, he told his congregation, you must believe that Jesus is the Christ, that congregation, even the unbelievers, they knew what he was talking about. But something has changed from the 18th century to our day. When I say the sinner must believe, many people think this. Oh, I believe in God. I believe in God. And that's not the entirety of what we are saying. So let me walk you through, and you see this in your notes, the nuts and bolts of saving faith. In other words, what is it that constitutes saving faith? And there's three Latin words that help us to unpack the meaning of genuine saving faith. The first is this, notitia. Notitia. Notitia is the Latin word translated faith, and it means this, that we have a basic understanding of the facts of the gospel. One of the things that we do when we walk people through the point of baptism is I want that person to be able to articulate the basics of the gospel, that the Lord Jesus Christ came, that he was born of the Virgin Mary, that he lived a life we could never live, that he died a death we all deserve to die, and that he was buried, and on the third day, God raised him from the dead, and anyone who believes in him and turns from their sins will be, someone help me, saved. They will be saved. Notitia is a basic working knowledge of the gospel, and the smallest of the small children can understand that. You can understand who Jesus was, and you can understand that Jesus lived and died, that he was buried, and that 3 days later he was raised. But that is not all that constitutes saving faith. Do you know that you can have notitia and still go to hell when you die? You must also have, it's the word, the Latin word, a census. And what a census means is that you not only have the head knowledge of the gospel, but you say, I embrace that. I not only know the facts of the gospel, I embrace it. And here is the key point. Do you know that you can have notitia, and then you can have a census, but you will still go to hell when you die? The third and crucial aspect of saving faith is what the reformers refer to as fiducia. Fiducia. And fiducia means this: I entrust myself to a person. And so you can know the facts of the gospel. You can say, I embrace the gospel. But you must also say, I trust Jesus. More than I trust Jesus, I entrust myself to him. He is my Savior. He is my Lord. In James chapter 2, verse 19, we read these very scary words. You believe that God is one. You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Demons in hell have notitia, that kind of faith. Demons in hell have a census. They have that kind of faith. But there is not one demon in hell who has fiducia. Here's my concern. We have Americans, even Americans who darken the door of churches, who say, I believe in God. In fact, I believe in Jesus, and I believe that Jesus died on a cross and he was buried, and on the third day, God raised him from the dead. Therefore, I'm a Christian. And they go and spend the rest of their week and they live like pagans. That person is not a Christian. The person who is a Christian is the one who believes in their head, who embraces in their heart, and then they entrust themselves to a person. And they say, here's the plan. From this point on, I'm going to do a 180-degree turn. I'm going to repent. I'm going to turn from my sin. I'm going to turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is my Savior. He is my Lord. I am experiencing daily God's saving plan in my life. I have been saved. And so we've posed three questions. Why do we need to be saved? What do we need to be saved from? And how can I be saved? And here's the bottom line. The bottom line is this: have each of you, have you come to terms with eternity? When you stand before your Creator and he asks, what have you done with my son? Will you have notitia, faith alone? Will you have a census along with notitia? Or will you have all three: head knowledge, heart embracing faith, and also entrusting yourself to a person? Will you be able to stand before God and say, I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead? Will you be able to affirm Romans 5:1 that says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God? Or will you stand before your Creator and will you say to him that I rejected the Son of God? I rejected him and I chose to live on my own terms. This morning, I want to challenge each of you to come to terms with eternity. Why? The book of Jonah says this: today is the day of salvation. And that's my prayer for you. If you're not a Christian, that you could say, today is the day of salvation. And if you are a Christ follower, may I challenge you to thank God for the salvation that is yours in Christ. When you do that, it'll have a profound effect on your life. It changes everything. And so I want to close by asking this question. Ask God, what does running to win look like for me in 2022? Who can I influence for God's glory? Who can I serve for God's glory? How can I spread a passion for the supremacy of God in my community, in my country, and on this planet that God has placed me? What are the practical application steps that I can embrace today to begin to run to win in 2022? I want you to join me in a word of prayer. Our God and our Father, thank you so much for the book of Romans. Thank you for your word that you have given us as your love letter so that we can know the God of the universe, so that we can be saved from the power of sin, saved from the penalty of sin, saved from the wrath of God, and saved from God himself. But thank you for the great freedom that we have in Christ, those of us who are professing faith in Christ. I pray that we would enjoy that salvation, that we would take delight in that salvation, that the fight for joy would continue. And for those here this morning that have not yet come to the place of submitting to the Creator of the universe, I pray that today would be the day of salvation, that they would believe in their heart, that they would confess with their mouth that Jesus is who he says he is, and that they would be saved, that they would affirm that, God, you raised Jesus from the dead. And so do a mighty work in someone's heart today, Lord. I pray that someone would be taking eternity seriously. Stir us up for amazing works that you have prepared for us in the coming year. Help us to run to win for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand.
Father, could you read his Father's Son?
singing, a story popped in my head. I was not planning on sharing this, but this is something that happened to me about 35 years ago. I had just graduated from Multnomah University, hadn't attended seminary yet, and I bumped into a buddy from Multnomah at the mall, and he said, "Do you have a little bit of time? I can buy you a milkshake." And I said, "Absolutely." We went to a place, sat down, and had a milkshake together, and he proceeded to tell me about some very serious sin that had invaded his life, that had occurred throughout his years at Multnomah, that continued to have him by the throat and was asking for help. And he chose not to receive the help that day. And I never saw him again, but I do know he is not living for the Lord in any way, shape, or form. In fact, he has embraced some teaching from some of the cults. And it's one of the saddest stories I could ever tell. Here is a young man, a gifted young man, he's not so young anymore, who chose to not take eternity seriously. He chose to not take eternity seriously. Proverbs chapter 3 offers this wise counsel: trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all his ways and he will make your paths straight. My friend chose to trust his own understanding, not trust the Lord. My challenge to you is, will you take the broad way that leads to destruction, or will you travel the narrow path that leads to eternal life? Will you take eternity seriously? Let's pray. So, Father, may we treasure your word in our hearts. May we find ourselves submitting to you, not only merely submitting to you, but joyfully submitting to you. May we recognize that the narrow path is the more difficult path, but the narrow path is the path to joy, the path to fulfillment, the path to true life. So, Lord Jesus, thank you for coming to be our Savior. Thank you for the gospel that we delight in. May we delight in it all our days. Not only the notion of the gospel, but may we live out the claims of the gospel throughout our days as we take eternity seriously. And all God's people said, amen. I want to invite Chris, is that right? The chairman of the board, to lead you through our next section.
All right, if you could take a seat for a second, please. Got a couple of items of business, a family business we want to take care of. First of all, the last couple of weeks you've heard it announced, or it's been brought to the congregation, that the board is putting Kyle Christensen up for a vote of affirmation as an elder to join our ranks on the elder council. Today was the day for our voting, so if the ushers come forward, we're going to do that real quick a minute. They'll hand out the ballots. If you remember, just raise your hand. They'll hand you the ballots, and we will quickly do that. Take 5 minutes to get this taken care of. Let's not forget the guys on the deck up here. If you accidentally get two, don't use them both. Yeah, and then pass them to the middle here if you could. We'll collect those in just a second. Got those. There's a bunch here, Tom. All right. We also have one more brief item of business. We've been kind of sneaking around as a congregation behind Pastor Dave's back for the last week or two. We might have some confession there, Pastor Dave, but as you all know, January 27th, was a interesting day, or it's a special day in our church's history. On January 27, 2012, Pastor Dave decided to join and come on board as our senior pastor, has been here 10 years as of today, or the 27th, of course, and we'd like to take a little bit of time to celebrate that. So Pastor Dave, if you could come up and take Jereen with you, we'll let Nate stay there. But if I get the elders to come up as well for a moment, that'd be fantastic. Did you find it? Behind the door. Where is that desk? That one. Yeah. Hey. Those of you who don't know, Ken just must have landed his helicopter. Ken was dropping off his daughter at the hospital, the airport. I think he was in Seattle about 45 minutes ago. That's impressive. And what's even funnier is he was commenting on the sermon all the way back, too, so I don't know who was driving, but that was impressive. So, yeah, obviously, Pastor Dave has been here 10 years now already, and it made me think a little bit about back in the day when we were searching for a pastor, and there are some funny comments. I can't share them all, but we looked for people that knew Pastor Dave. And we asked for people that were fans. We asked for people that weren't fans to come talk to us. And there was one guy in particular that stuck out, and it was not a fan. And and he thought he was doing me a favor. And I'm talking to him on the phone, and he's saying, you know, if you want a guy, you know, that's intense and doesn't like topical preaching, he doesn't like to exposit on Scripture, you know, he's not your guy. Little did he know, like, man, he was slamming it home at that point. And the interesting thing for me is that in all that input that we got on Pastor Dave, which was a lot, we talked to the Starbucks people, we talked to, you know, we've got a lot. We tried. We tried to find all we could find on Pastor Dave, and he's lived up to every last bit of it since then. And from what all those people had to say back then, he's still the same guy, and I find that remarkably refreshing. And that's a wonderful thing to be able to say. So. We've got a little lunch arranged today, so we're gonna have lunch here in a minute over in the fellowship hall. The ladies have been putting something together. We got a small gift for you from the congregation as well that we're gonna give you, and just wanna take a moment and thank you for 10 years of service here at Christ Fellowship. So please join me in thanking Pastor Dave. If we could, we'd like to take a moment with Pastor Marcus. Oh, sorry. Thank you. I'll explain that in a minute. I'll give you the nuts and bolts in a minute. We're going to take a moment. We're going to lay hands on Pastor Dave. I ask Pastor Marcus to say a word of prayer a moment. And then I'll give you the nuts and bolts on how we're going to go over there and enjoy fellowship for a few minutes.
All right. You join me in praying. God, we thank you for a great day so far. Thank you for just the great encouragement we got for Romans chapter 10 and for Pastor Dave, the work that he did in preparing for that and encouraging us with that. Lord, as we get to celebrate Pastor Dave and Jereen and just their family and appreciate so much the work that they have contributed to Christ Fellowship in the last 10 years, God, we just want to say thank you for them. Thank you for bringing them here. Thank you for truly all that has happened in these past 10 years, knowing that it is a part of your purpose and your plans, and you've used it for your glory. And we're just grateful for how faithful you have been to our church. I pray that today would be a great encouragement to Pastor Dave and Jereen, that they would know they are loved and that we value them greatly, and that today, again, would be a great refreshment. Thank you for being faithful to our church, for blessing our church with, again, Pastor Dave's leadership, for all the ways that Jereen has served in women's ministry and counseling other ladies, and just appreciate her so much as well. Thank you, God, for your goodness to us. We pray that you would bless the rest of our time together, bless our meal together. And again, thank you for all the people who have been involved in getting that prepared. And again, we pray that today would please you, would be an encouragement to our church, and it would bring glory to your name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, this is how it's going to work. We're going to let Pastor Dave and Jereen and Nate go out and get out there first and grab some food, and then you just make your way over to the fellowship hall. the ladies are ready there. You just walk by and they'll load your plate and do your thing. And if you get a moment to, take a moment to say thanks to Pastor Dave and Jereen, of course. If you want to fill out a card, there's a table off to the side there with some thank you cards. You want to fill that out, please feel free to do that as well. But by all means, Pastor Dave loves to be hugged and, you know, all the kind of things. I'll start if you want, but we'll give him a bottle of hand sanitizer. He'll be fine. So, all right, if you guys want to head out, we will allow you guys to go first, and we will follow them shortly. So, thank you very much.